Good morning. Have a seat, everybody. Make yourselves comfortable this morning. Well, I just got to tell you, first of all, before just while you're settling in, you guys, I'm so excited to see you. You look terrific today. You're smiling. You're filled with energy. And I'm so happy that each and every one of you is with us this morning to share this experience. And, you know, I heard about let me say this to you, too, before I even go any further. Happy Sunday. Hey, I heard about an experiment recently. It was done with a school district in the San Francisco Bay Area, and this is what they did. They called in three teachers to the principal's office before the school year began, and they said, you know what, you have been recognized by us as being the best teachers that we've got in our entire school district, and so what we would like to do is take 90 specially selected students. They're going to be students who are the best and the brightest. These are the students with the very highest levels of IQ in the entire school district. And we're going to give these students to you for the entire year. And we want you to let these students go. Let them learn at their own rate. Let them excel. Let them just go for it this year. And let's see how much they can accomplish. Well, they did that. They put the students in those special classes. And every single day, those teachers told the students, you guys are the best. We're proud of you. And every single day, those kids just excelled. And by the end of the school year, they had achieved 30% more than any other classroom in the entire district. At the end of the school year, the principal called those three teachers back into the room, and he said, I've got a little bit of a confession to make to you right now. Those weren't the best and brightest students of the district. In fact, they were not at all the most intellectually prominent students we have here. They were just average. They were picked at random and given to you. Now, the teachers felt really great about that. They said, obviously, then, they excelled like that because we're such awesome teachers. The principal said, I should tell you something else. You aren't the best teachers either. Your names are just the first three names that I happen to pull out of a hat. So the question is then, what happened there? Why were those kids able to excel and achieve that way? Why did they consistently outperform their peers? Well, the answer is because somebody was looking them in the eye and telling them every single day consistently, you're the best. I'm proud of you. It's the magic power of pride. It's the transformational power that you have when you look somebody in the eye and say, I'm proud of you. And you know what? Even Jesus needed that. Think about this with me. What's the first thing that happened to Jesus when he began his ministry? And I mean before he ever drew a crowd or preached a sermon. Before he ever raised the dead or healed the hurting. What's the first thing? The Bible says before Jesus did any of those acts of ministry, the sky opened up over his head and a great big booming voice came out of heaven and said, this is my son whom I love. In him I am well pleased. In other words, what was his dad saying to him? You're my son and I love you and I'm proud of you. You say, now wait a minute, Jeff, you're not telling me that Jesus needed to hear something like that. After all, Jesus was God. He didn't need to hear anything like that. Well, hold on a minute. I mean, just wait just one moment here. Maybe somewhere, just maybe, way down deep in that human side of Jesus, he needed to hear those words from his Father. We all need to hear those words. There was a study done by a psychologist by the name of Henry H. Goddard. Did this experiment years ago. He hooked up children to a device called an ergograph, which is a device which measures energy levels. And he wanted to see the results, the impact of words upon children. And what the ergograph showed is that if you give a compliment to a child, there is an immediate, sudden spike in their energy level. However, if you criticize a child, their energy level takes a nosedive. What I'm saying to you this morning is never underestimate the power of an encouraging word. Never underestimate the power contained in four simple words. When you look at somebody and you say, I'm proud of you. And today, I want to say that to you. Maybe I don't say it enough, but I just want to look you in the eye today. And I want to say to you, I love you guys, and I'm proud of you. I love you guys, and it is the honor of my life to be your friend and your pastor. In fact, I'll even be more specific than that. I'm proud of you, first of all, because you really know how to love. If you've been a part of this church for a while, you know that's true. The people in this church really know how to love one another. In fact, you all remind me of a church I heard about, one I read about. It was very famous years ago, a church down in Chicago. One January morning in the windy city of Chicago, now picture January in Chicago, the front doors of the church come bursting open, and the gust of wind comes in, the snow blows in, and this little boy walks into church. And one of the workers of the church came over to him and got down on her knees and gave him a great big hug and said, welcome to our church. We're so happy that you're here today. Where are you from? The little boy mentioned a neighborhood which was quite a distance from the church. The person said, well, you've walked such a long way to get here today. Why did you walk all that distance? You must have passed by at least a dozen churches in order to come to this church. The little boy looked up at her and said, because here, you really know how to love a fellow. You really know how to love a fellow. And I can tell you that for sure, that is true of this church. We had a woman in church recently, very first time in church, and we got to that part of the service, and you know, it's the kind of part of the service that makes all the new people a little bit nervous, because we say, cross over the aisles, shake somebody's hand, give them a hug, that kind of thing, right? Well, we get done with the service, I'm talking to her out in the foyer, and I said, well, how did you like our church? How'd you like that service? She said, well, to tell you the truth, I was in a really bad mood when I came here today. But it's just impossible to go to your church and stay in a bad mood. She said, how does anybody keep in a bad mood when people line up to hug them? Right? And it's absolutely true. In this place, we really know how to love a fellow. I remember Bobby. Bobby was 50 years old. He had Down syndrome. He was in church every single Sunday. And I'll tell you what, Bobby loved the music. Bobby loved the coffee. Bobby loved all of us. And he loved the Lord. And one afternoon, Bobby died suddenly. The next week, we had a memorial service in our church. And ladies and gentlemen, I tell you that there was not an empty seat in this place. Now think about that. Bobby was not one of the leading citizens in our community, and Bobby was not one of the biggest donors to our church. Bobby was not a success by the world's standards, but Bobby loved us, and we loved Bobby. Jesus said these words, by this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. A little boy sat in our church, and he comes every week, and he brings a toy each week, because his mom says, you can bring one toy to keep yourself occupied, so you don't get too restless in the service. So every week, at the end of the service, I always make sure I go over and say hello to him, and he shows me what toy he brought. And I always say something like, awesome, that's so cool. Well, recently, he held up a toy, and he said, I said, what is that? He said, binoculars. I said, awesome. Why'd you bring binoculars to church? He said, so I can see God better. Well, folks, you'll never see God better than when you see people who love one another. That's why Jesus said, by this, by your authentic level of love, by your commitment to one another, by the way you care about each other. He said, by this, all people are going to know that you really are one of my disciples. That's the distinguishing factor right there. If you love one another. This church was not built with bricks and mortar. This church has been built on the power of love. As your pastor, let me tell you again, I love you guys. And I'm proud of you. I'm proud of you also because you are exceptionally gifted people in our church. In fact, you want to see what an exceptional person looks like? Just look at the people in front of you. Look at the people behind you. In fact, if you want to see an exceptional person, you go home and look in the mirror. Because God created every single one of you to be an exceptional individual. That's why I'm proud of you. One Sunday, a teenager was waiting for me after all the services were over because she wanted to say goodbye to me. She was heading away from home for the first time in her life. She was heading off to college for her first year. And her and her mom were waiting for me out in the foyer. And I went out there and I said, you know, I remember when you were just a little girl coming to this church brand new. And right at that time, I said, you were just so gifted. And may God just bring out all those gifts in you right now and help you become everything that He knows that you can become. And I said, you know what? You're going to make God proud. And then I gave her a big hug. And I said, remember when you were small? I said, you remember you used to follow me all over the church and you always wanted rides from me, airplane rides. You would follow me around like this. And I would pick you up and give you these rides around the church like this. I said, you know what? When you're off to school, you're going to have some tough days. And the next time you have a tough day, I want you to remember that it's not going to be me carrying you through it. The good Lord Himself is going to be lifting you and loving you. He's going to be supporting you and holding you up and getting you through that day. Well, now I got the poor girl crying. And I've got her mom crying, but I don't cry because I'm too manly for anything like that. I just said, dude, you're not going to get this guy to cry. It's just allergies. My corners of my eyes are leaking. But let me tell you this. What I said to that young woman is true of every single one of you. You are loved, you are blessed, you are gifted, you are exceptional. And from the day you were born, the good Lord has been carrying you through life, getting you where you need to be. In fact, on the day you were born, your Father in heaven said one word. He looked at you and He said, wow. And then I bet He got on His phone right away and He texted Jesus. He texted Jesus, O-M-M, you know, oh my me. You ought to see this one. And then Jesus said, oh, this is a good one. I mean, to die for. And He did. You are exceptional. You're packed with personality. You're powered with ability. You're custom designed so that you can make a difference with your life and you can serve God and the people around you. In fact, this is the place you are right now, this is the place where you're most appreciated and celebrated as an individual. We're kind of like this unique club that I heard about. Let me tell you about it real quickly. Dr. George W. Crane was a professor at Northwestern University. And one day, one of his students came to his office hours, a young woman by the name of Lois. And Lois said, I'm thinking about dropping out of school. She said, nobody talks to me. I don't fit in. I don't feel comfortable in this school. Well, that got his mind racing. He tried to figure out what he could do about it. So the very next class, he said, from now on, I'm creating a brand new club, and I'd like you to be a part of it. It's called the Compliment Club. And here's what you have to do to be a member of my club. You have to find at least three different people every single day and give them an honest, sincere compliment. At least three people every single day, and you have to repeat that for 30 days in a row and then write a paper on what you learned. Well, and he said, by the way, you can't get an A in this class if you don't join my club. Everybody joined the club. Before you know it, under the influence of the Compliment Club, Lois was no longer lonely. In fact, she blossomed into a person that could just light up a room when she entered it. Well, you know, every single week when we get together as the people of Jesus Christ, let's make it a gathering of the Compliment Club. What do you say? Because people are hungry for compliments. People are hungry for kindness. People are hungry for appreciation. And somebody has to get the ball rolling. So why don't you do it? Before you leave here today, talk to somebody in front of you or behind you. If you go down to the Daily Grind, you see somebody standing alone, go over and talk to them a little bit. Join the Compliment Club. In fact, I'll go first. Ready? Here's my compliment to you. I'm proud of you. because you are exceptional. Let me say it again. I love you guys, and I'm proud of you. And what I'm saying is, be generous with your compliments. Be generous with your encouragement. Be generous when it comes to giving away your kindness. And as a bonus, guess what? It's going to come boomeranging right back to you. The Bible says, a generous man will prosper. He who refreshes others will refresh himself. In other words, every kind word you say, every kind thought you have, God will find a way to make that come boomeranging back to you in life. So aren't you glad you came to church today? You bet you are. And one more thing. I'm proud of you because you trust God. You really trust God, and you've proven it in this church. You know, our church is always the church venturing out into new territory. We're the church that runs not only a coffee house, but two child care centers, one in Springfield and one in Southwick. We're the church that's feeding the hungry, caring for the children, counseling the troubled, and making the Bible just kind of come alive for people. We're the church that's on the radio and online and on your phone and on your tablet and in bookstores and even on Amazon.com. Locally, by the way, we're on the air at 6:30 a.m. Yikes. I can't even get up that early to listen to me myself. But don't worry about it. Don't worry. Because we are on the air, prime time, drive time, rush hour, all the way from Pennsylvania to California, from Alabama to New Mexico. What? That's cool, right? Our church is always venturing out into new territory, and you're trusting God to make it work. Every week I just stand up here and I kind of just tell you the promises of God, but you're trusting God to come through for you. In fact, you sound like the people that Jesus was talking about when Jesus said, "Rejoice and be glad, because you will have a great reward waiting for you in heaven." You talk about a wow. You talk about a what? That's what I say. You know, in the Bible, in Hebrews chapter 11, it paints this great picture. Describes us racing through life. Doesn't it feel like you're racing through your life, like it's just crazy sometimes? It says you're running through life. It says, while you're doing that, we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. Such an interesting phrase if you stop and think about it. We're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. In other words, even though we can't see it with our human eyes, the reality is, those who went ahead of us are watching everything we do. The Bible says that Abraham and Sarah, Moses and Noah, they're watching us. David, who fought Goliath, Daniel, who's thrown in the lion's den, they're watching right now. And your loved ones who went ahead of you, they're watching now also. And they've kind of handed the torch off to us. And they're watching to see if we will carry that torch faithfully through the next generation. Men and women of Christ Church, when that great cloud of witnesses sees what you do every week, they stand and applaud. When they see dozens and dozens of children walk through those front doors every day, they stand and applaud. You're pushing into new territory, taking new ground, making kingdom history. And they're on their feet cheering when they see our love for one another, when they see our exceptional people, when they see our unwavering trust in the promises of God. They cheer us on. And so, like those heroes of old, I applaud you today. I love you guys, and I'm proud of you. Let's bow our heads and pray together. Father, I ask you to bless the people of Christ Church. Bring goodness and opportunity into their lives. Bring prosperity to their work, protection for their family. And as we run this race of life, I think of those who cheer us on from the stands. We want to make them proud. And Father, we want to make you proud of us. I pray this in the name of the risen Christ. Amen.